And I could see all the newsmen, they're very official, roped off. You couldn't get near them. Fascinating. They're going to report on it. And I suddenly see all these official showbiz types frantically running around getting photographed. And somehow I had that was the one discordant moment that I had in my own mind. I didn't see any of these great, these people who got their pictures in all the New York Times and all the papers. I didn't see one of those guys march. I'm sorry. I didn't see any of them do any of the stuff that all the poor little people who went down there to do did. And they're up there signing autographs, and they're frantically standing in the way of newsreel cameras and getting their pictures taken, signing autographs as though somehow they vaguely were responsible for goodness. You know, they've come to put official stamp on goodness in the world. And everybody was watching them. They're signing autographs. And all the while they're signing autographs, Martin Luther King is giving his talk, which was a brilliant speech, by the way. Martin Luther King is speaking, and these guys are standing around signing autographs, and the newsreel cameramen are taking their pictures. And all the while, Mr. King was giving a brilliant speech. Well, somehow I felt this was just one of those things. And what's so strange is not many of these guys that I saw up there were really, and even some of the people who were, in a sense, you might say, a couple of Negro authors and a lot of real hard-hitting, angry types were up there, and it was as though all of show business had gathered, and they were autographing each other and loving each other and taking pictures with each other, and all the while the real people were sitting down in the great crowd eating fried chicken and really digging each other for the first time probably in a couple of hundred years in America. And for one of the rare times in the world, I might also feel this is true. Nothing to do with American chauvinism, but it just happened that it was one of those days. And up there, you see business as usual with the celebs. Oh, boy. And if I had seen a couple of those guys marching, I would feel better about it. But I didn't see many of them do it. If they had been there without any name, without any... one guy I saw, and I will remember this, I saw him, a famous American author, sitting in a bush. And yeah, in a bush. He was not out there autographing. He wasn't up on the Washington Monument getting cheered or anything like that with the other guys. And I'm going through the bush, and there he's sitting there, and he says, "Hey, Shep." And he made a couple of comments. He says, "Boy, what a rotten beard." And I said, "Yeah." And I said, "What are you doing here?" And he's sitting in the bush, in a bush, drinking a Coke. And he's just sitting down there digging it. And I'm sure that in the end, this guy will know a lot more about what went on than those clowns who were up there on that great big platform. And I'm not trying to put him down. It was just somehow it was wrong. You know, somehow I felt very, very, that was wrong. And then I learned something about this. One of the guys, this is an interesting thing, one of the guys who organized the group that I was in, it's funny how you quickly can tell the honest from the dishonest when the chips are down. The guy who had organized it, he's working like mad, and for weeks he's getting the thing. He gets us there, and he's shepherding the group around. It's really tough. And he was so concerned with shepherding us around there. He was an actor, by the way, that when he finally got us in position, the gates had locked and he didn't get in. And who do you think, and there is this woman who is not even involved, as far as I know, in organizing all that. Her pictures are the ones that are in all the papers about it, you know. She's in front of every sign, you know, and waving. And the guy who really was doing something, he's not anywhere near there. Nobody even saw him during the whole thing. He was out there probably trying to get Cokes for guys that had fainted, you know, that kind of thing. Well, The whole thing was, I thought, a tremendously, to me, personally, a greatly, a genuine education. And I've been involved with this sort of thing for a long time. I've appeared on many programs off and on. That's one of the things that always bothers me, is to find myself on a program with 9 showbiz types who are trying out new material. You know, can you imagine trying out new material in human events? Oh boy. I've always felt a little sick about it, but yesterday I found out something that I will, for a long time, it's going to be difficult to forget, and I'm sure that I will, unfortunately. This is the way we are. But among other things, remember one little incident, the food incident. John Wingate. Did you hear about Wingate? Wingate, now, you know John Wingate. You know the reporters, you know, they've got the best of everything. And they do, you know. They go down, they stay in a hotel, and this is just the way a reporter has to work. He's got a tight schedule. He's not like the other people. Well, Wingate is down there in the coming down. He's been working all day long, and the newsman had a devil of a time, you know, sweating and everything else. And a large lady came up to him, and John is sort of standing there, and she offers John and gives John half of her lunch. She says, you know, you probably had a lot more work than I did, and here's this large colored lady with a flower dress is giving John the fried chicken. And John was absolutely, I knew this, John was, this just the way things went on today, they knew they were at something more than a news event. I saw Lester Smith in the crowd, and Lester Smith was one of the few times I've seen him absolutely thrown off base. He's one of the calmest, best reporters I've ever known, and John said, this is incredible. Just incredible. And the feeling, again, is a feeling that I cannot describe to you. I'm so glad that I went down there. Some of the funny little odd things that come along. A guy comes up to me, you know, and you learn true motives of people, too. And really, you know, oh boy, this guy comes up to me and he says, you know, he says, Shep, he says, I'll tell you, oh, isn't this great? And I says, yeah. He says, oh, man, look, it's great. He says, by the way, he owns a place in town, a restaurant or something. He says, boy, isn't this great? He says, you know what I want to do? He says, I wanted to take an ad out and says, I'm knocking off work and I'm going down to this thing. I want to take an ad in the paper and put it in and says, I'm knocking off work. And he says, I'm sorry I didn't do it now. You know, and I thought, oh boy, and the feeling, and then coming back was an incredible thing. Coming back was even more, in a way, I suppose. It continued all day long. You know, it wasn't just sitting at the monument and Washington and the Lincoln Memorial. Probably was never was more apropos. Never. And even the hard-bitten guys from Life magazine, the Time reporter, there was a guy named Kappa standing next to me, a famous Time reporter, and you could see it was a very funny feeling. You know, it was not a news story. You know what I mean by news story? It was an experience, an actual experience. And so he's standing there looking down, and everybody's looking around, and guys are hollering, their feet are hurting, and all the while, and the people are up there talking about human rights, and the human rights were being demonstrated. Everybody's, the words somehow didn't have much meaning, really. It was what was going on that had meaning. And it was just and everyone had a sense there, even the most militant, that the battle is damn near over. Now, in spite of the fact that everyone knows there's a lot of work and a tremendous amount, but it was like an affirmation of something that everyone had felt never could happen. And it was not just that it was held well. It was the attitude of everybody. It was just normal people on the streets. A great moment, I'll tell you that. It was a tremendously moving experience. And I've been involved in a lot of crowd movements before, and I'll tell you, I never had that kind of feeling. Coming back then, all the buses, you would expect terrible disorganization immediately as soon as... No, it wasn't. We're sort of drifting back in all the buses, and I'm sitting down on the big pond there, sitting down in the basin, waiting for our bus, and people are walking around, and they're drinking Cokes, and they're... All it was like a great company picnic where everybody knew everybody else. You know, hi, you know, they're waving, talking, eating, and so on. And finally, the buses assembled, and one by one, you could see the buses take off. Well, our bus starts to go back out, going north this time instead of south. And we're going north, and we're cutting through town, and all along the way of the route. And this is late; it was about 8:30, quarter to nine. There are people walking, waving at our bus. And they're just waiting, and our bus didn't have any big jazzy sign. It was just a busload of plain, ordinary people sitting in there. And they're waving, and they're hollering, and like, you know, come on, great you came, man. That kind of feeling. It wasn't a feeling of, boy, we showed them, didn't we? It was a feeling of, boy, you know, it was wonderful you came. And they just wave and they're grinning. And everybody, our bus is going out, and people are riding along in the cars, just ordinary people, you know, white people, everybody. And they were all waving at the buses out of their cars as we're going. And out we go. We're going north this time, out along the highway. Millions of buses, one after the other. A fantastic parade. And in the end, I'm sure it is a parade that no one will ever forget. A truly historic moment. And I don't think it is a historic moment politically either. It was a historic moment for a lot of people who did not conceive of people being this way. It's a new concept for them. For a moment there. At least for a moment it was there. And it makes everybody that much more irritated when you get back into real life. You know? Back into real life. It's like people who were in the crowd in VJ Day can't forget it. People who were in a crowd during a moment of genuine rapport. The minute you go back to the fist fight and the hollering and the yelling, somehow it tastes even bitterer. That fist fighting and hollering and yelling. And there's a strange, nostalgic feeling for that moment. You know, that great moment when everyone's passing the fried chicken around. And that son is sitting up there and they're singing the Star Spangled Banner. And that old man behind me is saying, but they're singing the Star Spangled Banner. We're usually quiet when they're singing the Star Spangled Banner, Matt.